Hello, everybody. This is Lots and Rock, 24/7 World Radio, your source for the truth. I'm so glad that you are tuning in from all over the world. What a blessing it is to know that you are there listening to the voice, the only voice, the voice of God, which is the Word of God. Well, God is just using me as a mouthpiece, as a servant that would bring God's word to you. And I'm so happy. I am so happy to be back. Last week, we were not able to be on the radio because I was in Nepal. And last 1 week, I was in Nepal preaching and teaching the word of God, serving God's people in the beautiful country of Nepal. And it was an incredible experience. We had to cross 7 mountains to get into the place that we were supposed to meet. And people came, pastors walked, because there's no transportation. And so pastors walked a whole day from one mountain to another mountain to attend the preaching of God's word, to attend the Bible conference there. Now, this was in the mountain, and I was like wondering, man, will there be any people? Because it took about 7 hours for us to drive from the village to the mountain. Just remember that. And it wasn't a very easy road. It was very difficult. Things were hard. And yet, when we reached there, we were able to see. We were able to see people, so many people who believed in the Lord Jesus Christ. And there were so many who did not. And there was a beautiful church building. And we were able to go and enjoy that wonderful work of God and be encouraged and encourage the people and preach the gospel. We had so many people trusting the Lord Jesus Christ. And we were able to encourage the brethren. And it was an amazing experience, amazing time there with the Word of God. And so that's the reason why I was not there last week. But I'm so glad I'm here again today to speak to you. And thank you to all of you tuning in right now, all over the world, from all over the world, from India, England, America, Pakistan, Australia. It's amazing. From Nepal, Bangladesh. Thank you. Thank you for tuning in. And so we are going to start again from where we left, from the book of Acts chapter 2. We left at verse number 38. Today we are going to look at 39 onwards. Right? So what's happening here is Apostle Peter standing up and preaching the word of God. Apostle preaching the word of God. And as Apostle Paul is preaching the word of God, they were pricked in their heart. That's what the Bible says. And they asked what we must do. And so Apostle Peter, he tells them what he must do, what they should do. They should repent. They should get saved. And they should get saved and they should get baptized. And they will have the power of the Holy Spirit, the gift of the Holy Spirit to do the service of God. And that's where we stopped. So, and the thing was, there are many false doctrines today where some people say you should be baptized only with this particular name and that particular name. And so we saw that last time. And if you have missed that, verse number 37 and 38, I would encourage you to go back to my YouTube channel, Lots and Rock. Just type Lots and Rock. Go to the playlist and say my radio show. And there you can see Acts chapter 2, verse 37 and 38. And that message you can listen. And that would be a blessing, I believe. So come to 39 today. So after Peter preaches, verse number 39, for the promise is unto you and to your children and to all that are afar off, even as many as the Lord our God shall call. So Peter encourages them and says, hey, God has promised to save you if you will repent and if you will turn away from your religion and turn away from your sin and come to Jesus. The Lord has promised to save you. And not only you, even your children, when they believe, will be saved and they shall receive the Holy Spirit. And yes, the truth is, everybody who believes in the Lord Jesus Christ shall have the promise of the Holy Spirit, the gift of the Holy Spirit, the power of the Holy Spirit in you and upon you. And so Peter shares the promises of God. And whosoever will call upon the name of the Lord, whoever believes in the gospel, shall be saved. Now come to verse number 40. The Bible says, and with many other words did he testify and exhort, saying, save yourselves from this untoward generation. Save yourselves from this untoward generation. So what Peter is saying is, Peter is trying to convince and preach the gospel, and he says, and with many other words. What is this many other words? Many other words basically is Peter bringing the Old Testament and preaching the Lord Jesus Christ, and he preaches the life of the Lord Jesus Christ. Peter tells the people, I lived with Jesus, we walked with Jesus, we talked with Jesus, we heard everything Jesus said, and Jesus died and was buried, and as he promised, he rose again. I want you to know that Jesus Christ is the true living God, and he was manifest in the flesh. And you need to believe in Jesus Christ. You need to turn away from your idolatry. And with many other words, and he would run to the book of Isaiah and preach Jesus. He would run to the book of Joel and preach Jesus. He would run to the book of Genesis and preach Jesus. And with many other words, Peter preached the gospel. What does that teach us? It says, with many other words did he testify and exhort, saying, save yourselves from this untoward generation. What does that teach you and me today? It teaches you and me, dear friends, when you walk with Jesus, you will have a lot of content. When you walk with Jesus, you will have a lot of subject to preach and teach. Today, a lot of people don't walk with Jesus. Their devotional life is dry. They don't even read their Bible. They don't even have a walk with God. And they wonder, what must I do? How can I share the gospel? I don't know how to share the gospel. I don't know what to answer. And even many preachers don't have a time, close time with God. And they wonder what they will preach the next Sunday. But when you walk with Jesus every day, when you are having a special time with Jesus every day, you don't have to be a preacher, but you as a Christian, everybody should have a time with God. You need to walk with God every day. Everybody should have a silent time with God, a closer time with God, a devotional moment with God. At least begin with the 10 minutes. And as you grow, have at least 1 hour with the Lord. You spend 10 to 10. Some people work 8 hours, 10 hours, 12 hours for their belly's sake. But hardly they have time for the Lord. And they'll think 1 hour is too much. It's a waste of time. Some say 30 minutes is too much. 10 minutes. Oh, no, I can do it with 2 minutes. All right, then start with 2 minutes. And from 2, go to 5. And 5 to 10. 10 to 30. 30 to 40. 40 to 45. Go up to 1 hour. Spend some time and look what will happen to your spiritual life, and look what will happen to your physical life, and look how your preaching will transform, and watch how your conversation with your unbelieving friends will transform, and watch how you will present the gospel and give an answer to everyone that will ask one. Yes, dear friend, that's when you will have many other words. When you are studying and reading the Bible every day, you will have so much to say. When you are walking with God every day, you will have a lot to say. When you're worshiping God every day, you know, a Christian is not called to worship God only on Sunday. We are called to worship God every day. We are not called to read the Bible only on Sunday. Some people don't even read the Bible on Sunday. We are called to read God's word every day. We are not called to serve God only on Sunday. We are called to serve the Lord every day. And when we do that purposefully, when purposefully we serve God, purposefully we read God's word, purposefully we pray, purposefully we devote our life and our time in serving and knowing God, oh dear friend, we will have so much in our heart and in our mouth to convince the people of the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ, to encourage the believer with many other words. And you will never be short with ideas and with words and subjects to preach and teach and to have a conversation. But rather, every day you will be able to share with the people. So I want to encourage you to have a personal time with God. Peter walked with God. Peter stood with God. Peter was in the upper room. Peter, for the next 40 days after Jesus rose again and came, met the people, he was with them for 40 days. 40 days teaching, 40 days training them, 40 days commanding them how to do the ministry. And Peter learned. And before that, for 3.5 years, Peter walked with God. Yes, he faltered, but he walked with God. Yes, he had doubts, but he walked with God. He saw God. He saw the Lord Jesus Christ. He saw the miracle that Jesus did. He saw the compassion of the Lord Jesus Christ. He saw how the Lord touched the lepers and cleansed them and healed the sick and he raised the dead. He saw how he wept with those who mourned. He saw how Jesus rejoiced with those who were joyful. He saw how he loved the children. He saw the holy anger when God's, the Father's house of prayer was turned into a business place. He saw Jesus. He saw everything about Jesus. And with many other words, when we stay closer with God, when we are having a close walk with God every day, dearly beloved, it will transform your spiritual life. It will transform your preaching life. It will transform your walk with God. It will transform your relationship with your spouse, your relationship with your children. It will transform your involvement and your relationship with church. And you will certainly be a blessing to so many people that will come across your life. Your conversation with the unbelievers will have a great influence and an impact upon their lives. Then the Bible says, you know, Peter, with many other words, did he testify and exhort, saying, save yourselves from this untoward generation. He was more concerned about people getting saved. He was not concerned about how to make money. He was not concerned about what career to choose. He was not concerned about how rich you can become. He was more concerned about your soul. Because that's the most precious thing. And that is what is neglected most today. But Peter was concerned about the most important thing, your soul. My dear beloveds, you may win the whole world. You may win the whole world. But what if you're? What if your What if your soul perishes? What if you go to hell and you don't get saved? Isn't it dangerous? That is very dangerous. And so Peter is inviting them to get saved. Save yourself from this untoward generation. Save yourself from this wicked generation that is leading you to hell. Come to Christ. And then he says in verse number 41, then they that gladly received his preaching, accepted the preaching. I want you to know, dear friend, nobody can get saved by your music and by your singing and by your entertainment, by your programs, by your devices and by your enticement. You can only get saved, and souls will only get saved through the preaching of the Word of God. The way to salvation, God paved the path to salvation through the means of preaching. Today, the church is totally changing. I was in some places and they say, Pastor, let's have this open air meeting. And for that open air meeting, they had dances. They made their girls dance so that unbelievers would come and listen. And culture cannot become superior to the Bible. We will come back to this interesting subject. Don't go anywhere. Take a short break. Come back right here.
This is 24/7 World Radio, your source for the truth.
This is Brother Jack. I invite you to listen to my broadcast on 247worldradio.com. I preach the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ to the Polish-speaking people scattered around the whole world. Furthermore, I defend the Reformation in Poland, Polish Protestants and Baptists, and Polish Reformation Bible. I also expose the Counter-Reformation in my homeland, led by the Jesuits and by the Roman Catholic Institution. Join me every Thursday at 5 p.m. Eastern Standard Time on 247worldradio.com. Tu Bart Jacek, zapraszam Was do wysłuchania mojej audycji na 247worldradio.com. Głoszę Ewangelię Pana Jezusa Chrystusa ludziom mówiącym po polsku rozproszonym po całym świecie. Ponadto bronię reformacji w Polsce, polskich protestantów i baptystów oraz polskiej Biblii Reformacyjnej. Demaskuję również kontrreformację w mojej ojczyźnie kierowaną przez jezuitów i przez rzymskokatolicką instytucję. Dołącz do mnie w każdy czwartek o godzinie 17 czasu wschodnioamerykańskiego na 247worldradio.com.
This is Eric John Phelps. Please listen to my broadcast, The Eric John Phelps Show, as I preach the true gospel of the risen Lord Jesus Christ, defend the Protestant Reformation that birthed Western civilization, and expose the counter-reformation of the Jesuit order seeking to make the Pope of Rome the universal monarch of the world. Join me every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday from 10 a.m. to 12 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, right here on 247worldradio.com.
You're listening to your source for the truth. This is 24/7 World Radio.
Welcome back. Welcome. I'm here waiting for you. The 24/7 World Radio. Here I am, Lords and Rock. And so we were looking at verse number 41. And I was telling you about how, we were having this open air meeting, and this particular organization, they invited several, they asked several groups of girls in their churches to have dances so that you know, the people, the crowd will be entertained, and then I could preach the gospel. And what this happened was people were excited and entertained with the dance, but when the time of preaching came, nobody was interested. My dear friend, I want you to know you cannot bring the world into the church, and the church should not be aligned with the world, but it is a two separate thing, and the worldliness should never be used for enticing people to the gospel, because it will never happen. The only way that God made it possible for the gospel to be proclaimed is through the preaching of God's word. And I was able to teach that church, and they very, very humbly accepted their mistake, and they repented of their sin, and they said, thank you for teaching us. Thank you for teaching us. We can be only through the preaching of God's word, we can win souls to Christ. My dear friend, let me also make it very clear that your testimony is nothing when it compared to the preaching of God's word. And when the gospel is presented, you should never go and share your testimony, because then it will overshadow and cause another problem. Your testimony you can share, but the word of God should be the highlight. It is the word of God that will save the souls, not your testimony. We need to keep these things in mind. Sometimes we think that our testimony would change people's lives, and so we think that I'm going to tell my testimony. I'm going to make 2 plus 2, instead of making 3 plus 3 is 6, we will try to put multiplication. 3 by 3 is 9, and we'll add more spice to it, and more water to it, and more sugar to it, and try to make us look better by sharing our testimony. We need to understand it is the preaching of God's word that will save the souls. It is the preaching of God's word. Nothing else. The way that God ordained is through the preaching of God's word. I will read what the Corinthians chapter 1 says. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, it says, verse 21, for after that in the wisdom of God, the world by wisdom knew not God. It pleased God. Look at that. It pleased God by the foolishness of preaching to save them that believe. Look at verse number 18. For the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness. But unto us which are saved, it is the power of God. It is the power of God. So it is the preaching of the gospel, it is the preaching of the word of God that will save the soul. And so what happened is when the word of God was preached, not the miracle, but the word of God was preached, people did not ask, how should I get saved? What must I do get saved, when they spoke in tongue in chapter 2, the first few verses. But when Peter got up and preached the word of God, they asked, what should we do? Tell us what we must do to be saved. So my dear friends, don't fall for the signs, wonders, and miracles, but rather fall straight to the preaching of God's word, because that is the hope of salvation. That is the hope for the nation, preaching. And that's why every man should pray that you will be a preacher of God's word. Now, everyone should be a preacher, not a teacher. The Bible tells us in the book of James that let not many be teachers, because in many words we offend people. And God says, let not many be teachers. Which means your job is to preach the gospel. That's it. Don't be a teacher. Don't try to teach doctrines. Don't try to teach people what would be the things of the church and ministry. No. Sometimes we think that now we know everything about the Bible. Have you noticed? When people go to work, They will not tell the boss what to do, what not to do, you know. They will listen to the boss, they will work, and they will get their paycheck, and they will go home. But the same people would go to church in a week or two, and then suddenly they think now they know everything about how to run the church, how to be a good pastor, and then suddenly they'll begin and they will start giving suggestions to the pastor how to do the ministry. Have you noticed that? Have you done that? But they will never do that in the job. But suddenly they will think that now they are qualified. They become the qualified one to give suggestions and ideas to the pastor and tell him how to do the ministry, how to be a good pastor. That's very bad. And we are not supposed to be teachers of God's word unless God has called you to be a teacher. Don't let many be teachers. But we should all be preachers of God's word. Everybody should be preachers of God's word. Everybody to share the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. It doesn't matter to which gender, we should share the gospel to everybody. And it is through the preaching, of the foolishness of the preaching, souls are saved. And so God used that. So Peter preached here, and they received the word. Look at that. Then they that gladly received his word were baptized. So you don't baptize you don't baptize the children. You don't baptize somebody because they came to church. You should not baptize them because they just followed you. You should, and people should be baptized. People should receive baptism only after and when they receive the word of God, which means only when they are born again, which means only when they are new creation, which means only when they believe the Lord Jesus Christ as their God, their Lord and Savior. And it is only then, it is only after that you should give baptism. Unfortunately, in Catholic churches and the Syrian churches and Methodist churches, they just baptize the child. While in the Bible, we don't read anything about baptism of the children, of the infant. We don't read about the infant baptism. We don't read about the sprinkling baptism. We don't read about the dumping baptism of the infant child that has no idea about what's happening in the world. And these are false churches. These are doctrinally in error. According to the Bible, only those who received the word, only those who believed in the Lord Jesus Christ should be baptized. Only those. That's what the Bible says. Look, then they that gladly received his word were baptized. Only those who received the word were baptized. And when they were baptized, what happened? And the same day, well, I will go there, but come with me to the book of Acts chapter 8. Let me show that verse about the Ethiopian eunuch. You know the story. The Ethiopian eunuch was coming back from Jerusalem. He had the book of Isaiah, and he was on that chapter, chapter 53. And while reading, he was not able to understand. So the Holy Spirit told Philip to go to the chariot. So Philip runs, and he says, "Understandest thou what thou readest in?" And the Ethiopian say, "How will I know unless someone explains to me?" And the Bible says, Philip opened his mouth and preached unto him Jesus. Right? That we see in Acts chapter 8, verse number 35. Then Philip opened his mouth and began at the same scripture and preached unto him Jesus. And as they went on their way, they came unto a certain water, and the eunuch said, "See, here is water. What is hindering me to be baptized?" And when the angel which spake unto baptized, and Philip, verse number 37, and Philip said, if thou believest with all thine heart. Thou mayest. And he answered yea and said, I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. And then we know that they went down into the water and got baptized. So what is happening here? First and foremost, the qualification to be baptized is salvation. You should be saved to be baptized. Baptism is not for those who are not saved. Baptism is not for those who are not born again. You need to be born again. You have to receive the word of God. As the Bible says, then they that gladly received his word were baptized. And then what happens? A lot of people, remember one thing, dear friend. Water baptism is the test of your true, genuine salvation. Because I can tell you as a pastor with an experience, a lot of people say, Pastor, I'm saved. But they don't want to get baptized because they're afraid what the world will think, what the society will say. Such kind of people are not saved at all. You may love Jesus. You may go to church. You may know about the gospel. But you're not saved. No. Because if you are truly saved, now you may understand the gospel, but you're not saved. Understanding the gospel is not salvation. Believing and receiving and God receiving you is salvation. And that is when you will be the person who will say, I want to get baptized. I want to be obedient to God's word. A genuinely saved person will not put forth away the baptism, but rather immediately will want to get baptized because want to be obedient to God's word. So it is wrong, and people are living in their fool's paradise. A lot of people, they think that I'm saved. I don't have to get baptized anyway. You know, everything is fine. Baptism is not salvation, and salvation is not true baptism. So I don't have to be baptized. But my dear friends, if you are truly saved, then you will get baptized. And if you're not truly saved, then you will not get baptized. But at the same time, just because you're baptized doesn't mean you're saved. It simply means you just got baptized. It just means you just got went into the water. You understanding? What am I saying? I'm saying that many people get baptized while they are not even saved. Many times the pastors want to make these numbers big, like, oh God, so many people got baptized, and they just dump the people into the water when they are truly not understanding the gospel, when they're truly not saved. So baptism is not salvation, but a one who is truly saved will be baptized. But just because you're baptized does not mean you're saved. Receiving Jesus and Jesus receiving you means salvation. And everyone that has received Jesus Christ will be baptized. And what baptism does is adds you to that local church. The spiritual baptism adds you into the body of Christ, and water baptism makes you the member of the local church. And that is the most important thing, the most important thing. Look at verse number 41. Then they that gladly received his word were baptized, and the same day, what happened after baptism? They were added unto them about 3,000 souls. Isn't that a miracle? That is the greatest miracle. Jesus said, you will do greater work than me. What is the greater work? Is there anything greater than, have you ever seen when someone taking the amputated or chopped off ear, putting it back? Has anyone seen that? In this day and age, only Jesus did it. Have you turned the water into wine? You can fake it. Like there is a guy called Charles Ibrahim from South Africa. He came to Goa and deceived the people. I made a video exposing him. And then once I exposed him, he went to the YouTube and changed his name. He took off his name, Charles Ibrahim, and he put some other name. I don't remember his name. But he changed completely because, he wanted to keep himself clean on the internet. But he's been exposed. And he tried to manipulate people's mind. But only Jesus Christ was able to turn the water into wine because there was a need for that. There was a need for the wine. And so, Jesus did many miracles. What is the greatest miracle any man has ever done other than Jesus? No. But then Jesus, when he went up to heaven after the resurrection, it was just 120 people gathered on the upper room. But when Peter preached in Acts chapter 2, verse number 41, the Bible says 3,000 people got saved. How many? 3,000. Now that is the greater work than Jesus Christ. Now, ultimately, it is Jesus who saves people. All right? At the end of the day, Jesus gets the glory, Jesus gets the credit. But at the same time, Jesus uses man to do the work of the gospel and the preaching. So Peter preaches and 3,000 people trust in the Lord Jesus Christ. How many? 3,000 people believes in the Lord Jesus Christ, and they were added to the local church. The Bible says, the same day they were added unto them about 3,000 souls. Can you imagine 120 plus 3,000? Now they have 3,120 people in the local church. What a great church, isn't it? That's a blessing. Anyway, we'll take a short break and we are going to get back. Stretch yourself, take a sip of water, come back. Don't go anywhere. We are going to continue with this great subject from the book of Acts chapter 2.
You're listening to 24/7 World Radio, home of Eric John Phelps and Vatican Assassins.
This is Eric John Phelps. Please listen to my broadcast, The Eric John Phelps Show, as I preach the true gospel of the risen Lord Jesus Christ, defend the Protestant Reformation that birthed Western civilization, and expose the counter-reformation of the Jesuit order seeking to make the Pope of Rome the universal monarch of the world. Join me every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday from 10 a.m. to 12 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, right here on 247worldradio.com.
This is Brother Nicholas. Join me every Tuesday at 2 p.m. Eastern Standard Time for the German Bible Truth Hour, and at 3 p.m. Eastern Standard Time for the Dutch Bible Truth Hour on 24/7 World Radio. This is Bruder Nicholas. Ich lade euch herzlich ein, mich anzuhören, jeder Dienstag um 2 Uhr nachmittags, amerikanische Zeit, für die deutsche Bibelwahrheitsstunde und 3 Uhr amerikanische Standardzeit für die niederländische Bibelwahrheitsstunde am World Radio 24/7. Dit is Bruder Nico. U bent hartelijk uitgenodigd om elke dinsdag om 2 uur amerikaanse standaardtijd het Duitse Bijbelwaarheidsuur te volgen en 3 uur amerikaanse standaardtijd het Nederlandse Bijbelwaarheidsuur te volgen op 24/7 World Radio.
This is 24/7 World Radio, home of Eric John Phelps and Vatican Assassins.
Welcome back to 24/7 World Radio, your source for the truth with Lotz and Rock. All right, so we were looking at how 3,120 people got saved, 3,120 people now in the church. You know why they were there? Because of the preaching of the Word of God. What a blessing it is. Now, here it is. A person who is genuinely saved will obey in water baptism. And a person who is genuinely saved will obey in water baptism and will be attending and joining a local church. Three things. They'll be doing that. There's no way that they can be saved and not want to get baptized and not want to be in the church. They will be saved and be baptized and be in the church. That is how God works. And then what happens? And they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine. Okay, doctrine is important. We have to study the doctrine. Because when you study the doctrine, what happens? You become stronger. They were not just making them how you're going to be rich and how you... No, they were being taught the doctrine. The apostles' doctrine. And the Bible says, and they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and fellowship and in breaking of bread and in prayer. So first and foremost, it's the doctrine. So you get saved. Secondly, you got baptized. You get into the local church. And then what do? You learn, you get the doctrine of God's word. And then you fellowship. And you break, you break bread, which means you have the Lord's table. And you pray. And you pray. This is how the church should exist today. This is how the church should exist. And this is how you cannot change it. This is how it should be. And if this is not happening, then that is not a church. That means you as an individual have a problem. If you're not getting baptized, you claim to be saved, but you're not getting baptized, you have a problem. You may not be saved. And so God says, hey, if you I want you to get saved, and immediately after getting saved, I want you to be baptized. Immediately after you're baptized, I want you to join the church. And once you join the church, I want you to grow in the doctrine of the apostles, doctrine of Christ. And then immediately after that, I want you to participate in the Lord's table. I want you to pray as a church and as an individual. And when you do that, you understand, yes, I'm in the right church. I'm doing the right thing. I'm thankful to the Lord that God led me to this church. I'm thankful to the Lord that the Lord saved me and brought me here. You can be thankful to the church for that. You can be thankful to the Lord for that. You need a preacher who preaches the word of God just as it is. Not the one who tells you how to be happy, how to become rich, how to have a good career, and how to just live a happy life. No. If you're in Christ, God will give you peace. But God wants you to grow in His word. You know, to find a church that teaches and preaches the word of God, that teaches you the doctrines, because it is the doctrine that will strengthen you. It is the doctrine that will help you to grow in God's word. And then when we do this, and fear came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were done by the apostles. You know what happens, dear friends? When you do what the Bible says, you will have the fear of God. The problem with many people today, there is a lack of God's power in people's life and a lack of power in the church life, because there is no fear of God in the church and there is no fear of God in the world. It is the church that should be more fearful of God. I don't want to hurt God, and that's why I fear to hurt Him, and that's why I want to do the right thing. Too many people just want to love God but not fear God. Now, the fear of God does not mean you run away from Him. The fear of the Lord is you run towards Him because you love Him, because you don't want to hurt Him. You don't want to grieve the Holy Spirit, and you don't want to fall into temptation. And so you run to God. That is the fear of God. The love of God will always draw you in the fear of God to come closer to God. Yes, This is biblical ways. This is how it functions. There is no other way, dear friend. You can say what it is, but this is simply what the Bible states. Every church should function this way. And when you do it, God's fear will come upon you. You'll live a holy life. Your church will live a holy life. Your church will function in the fear of God. Your church will walk in the fear of God. And God will do many great miraculous work. He will do. He will do many wonders in your life. He will do many signs in your life. Yes, I believe He will do great wonders and signs and miracles in your life. I believe God is all powerful. God is not done with that. God still heals people. God still does wonders and miracles. Should I tell you a wonder that happened when we were in Nepal? What happened? We had to climb this mountain, dear friend. I don't know how to explain to you. We had to climb this mountain, seven mountains, and only one Jeep can go through that road. If any other Jeep comes, there's no place. So, and if a landsliding happens, gone, finished. And so we went up. We crossed 7 hours journey. We went up. We went to this place, this mountain. We had a church service. And it was actually a rainy season. They said, oh, it's going to rain. And, you know, and 9 days before the meeting, the church got together and they began to pray to God. They began to pray to God that that rain will not come. You believe it or not, dear friend, for 2 days, two full day, complete day, there was no rain, not a single drop. And then, immediately after the meeting was over on the second day, a great shower began. For 45 non-stop, 45 minutes non-stop. And it was not all over. It was in that particular village only and upon the church building. It was a heavy shower. And the people came to me and said, shall we cancel the journey today because of the rain? We're not able to go. We'll go tomorrow. We'll stop today. I said, no, we'll just pray. The Lord will stop the rain. Now, the miracle is, it was a rainy season. The church got together and prayed that it will not rain. They fasted and prayed for 9 days that the 2 days that we are planning for the meeting will not rain. And God answered, it did not rain. And immediately after the meeting, it rained. It's a miracle. It's a miracle. And then it only rained in that particular village, and the people were a little worried about us, like, what if we go and the roads are soft because there's no proper road, it's a muddy road, and the rock and the landslide may happen, and they were like worried, and we said, no, we had to go today anyway. And we prayed and we made a way. Once we got out of that village and we started moving one mountain to another all through the journey, there was no rain at all. It was a dry land and we were able to come safely back. God still does wonders. Yes, God still does wonders. There is another testimony that I can share with you, dear friend. And this testimony is, I don't know how people will take it. We were having this open air meeting and there was only one focus light that was focusing upon me and the choir and the musical instrument. There was no other lights on any other direction. And while I was preaching, this is in the night when I was preaching, I was able to sense this possession of the evil spirit upon people. And on my left hand side, there was a couple of women who were gnashing their teeth and biting their teeth and making loud noise and then laughing, and they were possessed with the evil spirit. And while I'm preaching, I'm able to sense this, and God is just, you know, God is making this very clear to me that these people were possessed. And at that very moment, I stretched my left hand towards this side, towards the left side, where these women were all possessed and laughing. And I told the congregation, "Here, this way, people are possessed." At that very moment, somebody took a picture of me while preaching. From top, there is a light that falls on me. From the top, the light falls on me straight. I cannot explain to you that. It was just God giving a sign that I got your back. I am protecting you. You're protected. You're protected. And God is doing a mighty work in that manner. God does a mighty work. God still does signs and wonders and miracles. Not man, God does it. I don't think anyone should have a tough time in believing that God is able to do it. So, my dear friends, I want you to understand, with God, all things are possible. If you will get saved, get baptized, get yourself in a local church, start studying the doctrine of God, participate in the Lord's table, pray, and you watch how, and walk in the fear of God, and you watch how God will work wonders in your life. God will do signs, wonders, and miracles in your life. And so I want to encourage you with this. And I think I will stop here, and we will join together next week from verse number 44 onwards. And then we will grow in this manner and walk in the fear of God. So, dear friend, if this message has encouraged you and taught you something, why not? Let me know. Write a text message or an email to me, wherever you are, from whichever part of the world. Just write to me, lordsandrock@live.com, L-I-V-E, live.com. Send me an email. Encourage me. Send me a WhatsApp message. Let me be encouraged that I know that God's word is making a difference in your life. If you're in Goa, why not come to our church? Join us in serving the Lord. Every Sunday, we meet at the International Center at Dona Paula, 9 a.m. every Sunday. You know what we do? We preach the Word of God. We sing God's praises. We fellowship with the fellow believers. And we give God the glory and honor and praise. So I just want to encourage you. Walk with the Lord. If you're not saved, get saved today. Because Jesus Christ is the one true living God. He became man. He came into this world. He took your sins upon him. He shed his precious blood on the cross and he died. He was buried. And on the third day, the Lord Jesus victoriously rose again. And if you're a sinner, you turn away from your religion, turn away from your sin, because your religion, your sin, your idol will not save you. So you turn away from that and you turn to Jesus Christ, because only Jesus Christ can save you. And you believe in the Lord Jesus and you say, "Lord, I believe in you. You are the true God. And you became man. You came into this world. You died for my sins by shedding your blood. You're buried and you rose again. Lord, I believe with all my heart. Save me. Forgive me." And right this moment, God will forgive you. And he will make you his child. He will receive you if you receive him. He will never forsake you. He will never let you go. And he will always hold you in the palm of his hand. So I encourage you, dear friend, trust in Jesus today. If you're saved and not baptized, you better get baptized this week. And if you don't go to church, oh, dear friend, that's the most important thing. Find a Bible-believing Baptist church and go and join that church. A Bible-believing church, a church that believes the King James Bible and teaches from the King James Bible. Go and join that church and grow in the Lord Jesus Christ, grow in the Word of God. So I encourage you to do that. May the Lord do great and mighty works in your life. And just write to me, encourage me, and may I encourage you. And tell somebody, dear friend, tell somebody about the Lord Jesus Christ. Don't be a lazy Christian. Don't think it is the work of a pastor only. Don't think it's the work of your neighbor only. Don't think it's the work of your friend only or the church member. You are supposed to be a witness for Jesus Christ. So I encourage you to please tell everybody about the Lord Jesus Christ. Right? So I can sign off now. Thank you for joining with me. All Force for the Truth. Next Tuesday, same time, same channel. I'm going to join you again. I'm going to introduce my channel to somebody. Invite them to join us on Tuesday at this time. The Word of God. That will create a great movement. The Lord Jesus Christ. God bless you. And I love you in the Lord Jesus Christ.